Welcome, I'm Nina Griffin, and this is the Astrology and Magic Channel. Today, we'll talk about the July 2021 astrology forecast. First, I wanted to say thank you to all of my patrons who will receive this forecast a little bit early compared to the general public. It will be available to the public July 1st. If you would like to join my Patreon family, you can go to patreon.com/ninagriffin. Now first, let's get started with talking about June as a retrospective, just to help us sort of ease into the influences of July. Now June was a pretty active month. We had Saturn square Uranus, the second of the three aspects of this year. We had Jupiter turning retrograde, and we had an eclipse. So it was a pretty active month compared to some of the preceding ones. I would say that on the whole, this was a month for making deals, and a lot of these deals were being made. You know, they were about balancing that revolutionary fervor shown by Uranus, as well as boundaries shown by Saturn. But the problem is, because of all the retrogrades going on, including Mercury retrograde, a lot of these deals didn't really have much longevity. It was a lot of activity, but it didn't really result in too much that was lasting. Now, July is going to be a little bit different. And don't forget that as July starts, we are still influenced by the June 24th full moon at 3 Capricorn. Lunation's influences usually last approximately 2 weeks, and this is no exception. So the theme of this particular full moon is going to be boundaries, and even though limits and restrictions are going to be in place, they won't be necessarily visible. Now that Saturn square Uranus narrative that makes it seem like anarchy is winning is definitely going on in early July. It will seem more credible. You know, could it be that Saturn is going to lose this one and Uranus is going to win? I think it might seem that way this summer, although I think by the end of the year, this is one struggle that Saturn is ultimately going to win, for better or for worse, depending on the situation and, of course, depending on the location. It's just that this middle act of the play, if you will, you know, adds a little bit of spice and it makes it seem like Uranus is going to take over. Now let's take July week by week. The first week of July, starting July 1st, we have a Mars opposition Saturn at 12 Leo and Aquarius. And of course, because it's happening in fixed signs, this will set off that Saturn-Uranus square. And as I've mentioned in many previous forecasts, Mars aspecting this configuration always adds intensity to that negotiation between anarchy and repression. This whole year really is an adjustment about where we end up on that spectrum personally and especially collectively, because of course the slow planets are involved. Now, as I've also mentioned many times, Saturn-Uranus is associated with epidemics, so we can see a rise in cases making its presence known around this time. You know, right now it's probably going to be that super contagious Delta variant of coronavirus, but this particular combination with Mars and Saturn, especially with Mars in a fire sign, will also be associated with fires. And certainly in the West, on the West Coast where I live, I'm sure we will see a lot of wildfires and very elevated temperatures around this time. July 3rd, Mars then will square Uranus, so he will trigger the other side of that aspect at 13 Leo and Taurus. And of course, this continues the theme he just started a few days ago. Really, so that whole week and all of late June, early July has that combustible and unsettled tone that Mars is going to really inflame, if you will. July 4th, Independence Day in the US, Mercury will reach his maximum morning elongation at 21 Gemini. And what this means is that Mercury on this day is as far from the sun as he can be. Mercury and Venus always travel with the sun. They can't go beyond a certain distance. And so in this case, Mercury has reached the end of his leash, if you will, and he is as far away from the sun as he can be. Now, because he is oriental of the sun, because he's rising before the sun, it's a moment of empowerment and independence for any planet. In Gemini, Mercury is masculine, and so he likes being oriental of the sun. He likes walking before the king. So Mercury ruling business and schools, you know, the mercurial parts of society, are going to be kind of doing their own thing, perhaps ahead of the times in some way, certainly ahead of whatever the government is telling them to do, as symbolized by the sun. Now, week two is going to be very active as well. Again, on that Saturn-Uranus axis. July 6th, Venus will oppose Saturn at 12 Leo in Aquarius, so she represents another trigger of that Saturn-Uranus square, very much close on the heels of Mars aspecting Saturn and Uranus. Venus will then square Uranus July 8th. And what this means is that we actually have two planets triggering Saturn-Uranus in close succession. And to me, this just means that that Saturn-Uranus tension, whether it's societal, whether it's personal, whether it has to do with the pandemic, is going to be very noticeable. It's going to be particularly in your face that first week or two of July. Now, that same day that Venus opposes Saturn, July 6th, the Sun will conjoin the fixed star Sirius, the dog star. Now, Sirius is the brightest star in the sky. And if you've ever heard that term, the dog days of summer, this is what is referred to here. Whenever Sirius rose, this is of course in Egypt, it was associated with the start of the flood season of the Nile. However, it is also associated with plagues and diseases. Certainly Sirius brings heat in the Northern Hemisphere, and in our world in the 21st century, that often means fires. So anytime a planet, particularly the Sun, conjoins Sirius or Procyon, who is the other dog star, in the summer, especially if it's the Sun, we will get that period of heat and also aggression, as well as, of course, anything to do with plagues and contagious disease. Now, July 9th, we have a new moon at 18 Cancer, and the moon herself will be the ruler of this lunation. The moon is dignified in her own sign, but she is combust because she is close to the Sun, and she has no light. Now, you could also say she is Kazemi, but for the moon, primarily, she is mostly impacted by the fact that she has no light. That pretty much takes precedence over the fact that she is Kazemi when she is exactly new. Now, she is also void of course, right? She's not going to be making any major aspect to any visible planet in the near future. So there's this sense for the next couple of weeks that matters are at a standstill. There could be fluctuations because that is the nature of the moon, especially in her own sign, but there isn't a sense of clear direction for things. So certain things will move ahead only with a lot of difficulty. In general, even though this moon is in a cold and wet sign, Cancer, it's a very hot new moon in terms of weather and temperatures because of the moon's combustion. Now, July 11th, Mercury will enter Cancer. It's going to be a bit of a come down from his own domicile, Gemini, where he spent all this time this year, but he is no less busy in Cancer. Cancer is the sign of movement and fluctuation because it is ruled by the moon, who likes to go places really fast. And Mercury in Cancer, because Cancer is a mute sign, the water signs are all considered mute, this placement is less about the constant communication we've been seeing, as in Gemini, and it's more about making changes and going places. So we're not necessarily announcing our plans, we are just moving and changing very rapidly. Now, week 3, July 12th, Mercury will trine Jupiter at 1 Cancer and 1 Pisces. Now, this is kind of an interesting aspect because Mercury is received by Jupiter into his exaltation, so it's a very mobile and very fruitful combination. Again, Cancer and Pisces being water signs are both mute, so this combination isn't particularly communicative. It just sort of expands and grows without announcing its intentions. Religious changes and educational changes could be happening right now. Certainly anything to do with students, whether it's basic education or higher education, is going to be very important. The next day, July 13th, Venus will conjoin Mars at 19 degrees Leo. And I think that this combination in terms of weather is definitely going to lead to some fires, to excessive heat. It's just a combo that seems to lead to a lot of, well, fires and heat. It could also lead to storms, which then could trigger fires because of thunderstorms. Now, remember that whenever these planets are in fixed signs, they're going to be aspecting the Saturn-Uranus square. And so we're really going to see those COVID cases, and we're going to see extreme weather. So if you live out west, hopefully you will have purchased an air purifier by now. I think you will really need it in July. Now, week 4 is quite active. July 19th, the Sun will conjoin Procyon, which is the little dog. It's the other dog star. So it continues the theme of dog days, of heat and fires, aggression, Procyon is more barky than bitey, so I would suggest that this is a time of perhaps fights of aggression, although not necessarily following up on one's threats. July 20th, the next day, Mercury will conjoin Sirius. So again, we have that dog theme triggered by Mercury as well as the Sun this month. Now, July 21st, Venus will enter Virgo. And this is the sign of her fall, but it is a significant cooling down from her travels in Leo. And I think that in terms of the weather, this placement is helpful in reducing the sheer heat for the next few days, at least until the Sun enters Leo. So we might get a little bit of a respite with Venus exiting Leo, moving out of Mars's orb, and going into a cold and dry sign at least. July 22nd, Venus will oppose Jupiter at 0 Virgo and 0 Pisces. And this is kind of an interesting aspect because the benefics are working against each other right now, right? It's almost like we have two good options that are on offer. One is genuinely good, represented by Jupiter in his domicile, but it might be slow in coming because he's retrograde. The other option represented by Venus may appear good, but is much less so because she is in her fall. And as we know, benefics in their fall tend to overpromise and underdeliver. Now, the same day, we also have Venus conjoining Regulus. That's July 22nd still. Venus, of course, is very regal here, but she is modest. And I always think of this combination as the Queen Elizabeth I combination. She is very powerful and queenly, but she plays down her power, right? She is the Virgin Queen. She's like, oh, I don't want to get married. But in reality, it's just because she doesn't want to share her power. That same day, the Sun will enter Leo. And so I think weather-wise, the heat will be on for at least another week while Mars is still in Leo as well. So I think yet another opportunity for fires, for heat waves, things like that. July 23rd, we get a full moon, and it's going to be at 1 degree Aquarius, so it's ruled by Saturn. And in this chart, Saturn conjoins the moon and opposes the Sun. So the theme for the next couple of weeks, late July, early August, will be the theme of boundaries and structure, right? Saturn is going to be very dominant right now. And especially given that the moon's next aspect after this full moon is a conjunction with Saturn and also a square with Uranus. So I would say that the next 2 weeks is when things really begin to turn, right? So far we saw like anarchy is winning, you know, no rules, yay. Suddenly we've got this shift into rules again. So I would say anarchy zero, authoritarianism one. Now week five, that last week of July, July 25th is Mercury's morning set into the Sun's rays. Mercury is very fast now, and he runs into a period where he is near the Sun and he is invisible. So during this period, his power will be less, or at least less obvious than usual. What is good for him is that he is received by the Sun because he's in the Sun's domicile. And this helps reinforce their bond. It makes that conjunction more powerful, more effective. And so I think that during this period, business deals and negotiations will be hidden, but they will actually be pretty effective and potentially lasting. They just won't be there on the surface for everyone to see and critique. July 26th, Mercury will conjoin Procyon. And so, of course, this is going to be the last planetary conjunction between the dog stars and the planets, not counting the moon. So this is kind of the winding down of those dog days of summer. Now, the very next day, Mercury will enter Leo, July 27th, and so that will heat things up again. It's not quite as strong as, of course, having Venus in Leo or other planets because Mercury's always close to the Sun. But we're definitely going to get some warmth and potentially warm winds that again could lead to fires. You can see a theme this month for sure. July 28th, Jupiter will retrograde back into Aquarius from Pisces. And so, you know, the idea of kind of no boundaries represented by Jupiter and Pisces got a bit of an airing. It got a trial run, if you will. But now we're back into talking about infrastructure and the public good and the long term. And we're sort of holding each other at arm's length again for the good of everyone. Whether that means, you know, some places go into lockdown, social distancing, more masks, all of those Saturnia things that are supposed to be good for you because it's Jupiter. Nonetheless, we are going to see them kind of make a comeback at the end of July in a lot of places. July 29th, Mars will oppose Jupiter at 29 Leo and Aquarius. So just like I said, there's going to be these, you know, this new or sort of returning trend of infrastructure discussion and boundaries. You know, if people will have to wear masks again, they're going to be angry. But it's going to be a losing battle for them because Jupiter is naturally superior to Mars. Now, the same day, July 29th, Mars will enter Virgo and he will conjoin Regulus at the same time. Mars is a lot less fiery in Virgo than in Leo, which I think is good for temperatures, it's good for keeping fires down a little bit, but he's on Regulus, which is a very militant, very dominant fixed star, so he's still very feisty. And I think that around this time at the end of July, we can expect a lot of chest beating by martial types, even though I think that they will have gotten their rear ends handed to them by Jupiter in that opposition. So to summarize, if June felt a little bit like anarchy, July feels like the screws of control are tightening in reaction to that earlier chaos. The full moon in Aquarius and Mars confrontation with Saturn, Uranus, and finally Jupiter make it clear that opposition and disorderliness will not be tolerated. Again, COVID will make a resurgence in some places, requiring more boundaries and limitations, which I think will be a bitter pill to swallow for a lot of people. As I said so many times, it will be a very hot month in many locations, and the risk of fires will be extremely high. August, I think, promises to be slightly better in that regard, so we have something to look forward to, although I think that we won't be fully out of the woods on extreme heat and fires until about mid-August. All right, thanks for watching. I'm Nina Griffin. Please subscribe to my channel, and I'll see you next time.